This is improved version of the previous Rust versus Go benchmark. I got a lot of tips how to improve Rust code along with a couple of PRs, which I'll talk about in a minute. Many people also complained that using Fiber wasn't a fair comparison, so I switched to the standard Go library for this benchmark. If you haven't seen the first benchmark, I start by comparing the frameworks themselves, specifically Rust ActX and Golang standard library. I have endpoint that returns hardcoded devices in JSON format to the client. I measure CPU usage, memory usage, and the latency for processing each request from the client side. Additionally, I analyze how many requests each application can handle, their availability, and CPU throttling, since I run these tests in production-ready Kubernetes cluster in AWS. And finally, we push both applications to the breaking point. Now, the second test is a bit more interesting. I have implemented a common use case where application reads a file from the local file system, uploads that file to S3 bucket, and saves metadata about that file to a relational database. In my case, Postgres. I'll cover those graphs as well. First of all, Fiber is built on top of FastHTP, which is why it's very fast. However, FastHTP was designed for specific high-performance edge cases. If you need to handle thousands of small to medium requests per second and require consistently low millisecond response times, you may want to consider using this library. That said, they themselves recommend using the standard Go library by default for most cases. There are a few advantages to using the standard .NET package over FastHTP. For instance, it supports HTTP/2, is more stable, and handles more HTTP corner cases and other benefits. So if you're working on a personal project, using Fiber and FastHTP is perfectly fine. However, if you're developing software for corporate clients, be sure to carefully review all the risks before choosing this framework. Thanks to many, I got a lot of tips how to improve Rust code. First of all, you can add additional section to your cargo file, which will be used when you compile your code in release mode. First, set LTO to true, which stands for link time optimizations. It can produce better optimized code using whole program analysis at the cost of longer linking times, which is totally fine with me. Next, set code gen units to 1. A higher value means your code will take less time to compile, but may result in slower performance. The valid option is any integer greater than 0. Finally, set panic to abort, which terminates the process immediately when a panic occurs. You can read about all the optimization options on these pages. Links will be provided in the video description. Now, let's take a look at the code improvements. In the first test, my Go code used UUID of type string, which is fine. However, in the original Rust code, I used UUID type, which could potentially be slower to convert to JSON. Thanks to Divit, who noticed this and submitted a PR, which I immediately accepted and merged. I also received another PR from Devashish. Apologies if I mispronounce your name. For a full rewrite of my original Rust code. This made a huge difference, making the code much cleaner and more organized. There was a lot of refactoring and updates in the code, and I'll link both the original and improved versions in the description, along with the PRs. For example, instead of using a string for UUID in the device struct, we can now use a more optimized copy-on-write type, among other improvements. In any of my benchmarks, if you notice anything that can be improved, please let me know, or better yet, create a PR with a description, and I'll definitely test and merge it. Again, thank you to everyone for the tips on how to improve the code. Alright, let's go ahead and run the first test. First, I'll run both applications in idle state for 15 minutes. You can see that Golang uses much more memory from the start and also slightly more CPU. All right, let me deploy the test jobs in Kubernetes as well. I run these tests in AWS using EKS cluster. You might have noticed that I use large EC2 instance types like 4 extra large or 8 extra large. This doesn't mean that applications have access to all CPU or memory of those machines. Instead, in Kubernetes, you define pod requests and limits. For example, when we measure CPU or memory usage in percentages, we use the defined limits and calculate how much of the resources application uses relative to those limits, not the entire virtual machine. Alright, you can see that when we start the test, Rust application latency is lower than Go this time. This is partially due to the code improvements, as well as the fact that I'm using standard library instead of a fiber. In the previous benchmark, I compared fiber versus standard library versus Gin, so you might want to check that benchmark as well. We also have a requests per second graph that uses histogram count and applies Prometheus rate function to calculate how many requests per second each application receives. Keep in mind that both latency and requests per second measured from the client side, not the application itself. This gives you a more accurate picture of what actual end user would experience when interacting with your API. If you deploy your applications to Kubernetes and use Ingress controller like Nginx Ingress, you can collect all these metrics directly from the Nginx Ingress controller for each application, instead of instrumenting every application individually. I have a video explaining how to do this. Now, let's talk about availability. It is calculated as the number of successful requests divided by the total requests, multiplied by 100. We also apply a rate function to measure how availability changes over time. For example, if clients start to receive requests with 400 or 500 status codes, your availability will decrease. In this particular benchmark, where the average request duration is under 1 millisecond, I defined a client timeout of 100 milliseconds. While this is not typical for most applications, in this case, I'm returning hard-coded values to the client. So if it takes longer than 100 milliseconds, it means our application has started to degrade. Also, if a request takes longer than 100 milliseconds, the client receives 408 status code, which also impacts availability. Finally, we have throttling. This occurs when your container in the pod reaches 100 CPU usage, and Kubernetes starts throttling it, which affects your application and increases response time. If you're running CPU-intensive applications like Nginx Ingress Controller, you need to closely monitor CPU throttling and latency. The entire test took around 2.5 hours, but I have reduced it to a few minutes for this demo. Now, we gradually increased the number of requests to each application, and you can see the differences in their behavior. The Golang application uses much more CPU than the Rust application, and its latency is also higher. At around 14,000 requests per second, Golang application begins to degrade. Since it reaches 100 CPU usage, Kubernetes starts throttling, which causes the latency to increase. In the availability graph, you can also see that some requests start to time out. With this configuration and pod limits, Golang application can only handle up to 14,000 requests per second. Now, let's run the test for a few more minutes to find the breaking point of the Rust application. At around 25,000 requests per second, Rust application also started to fail. In Kubernetes, failure doesn't necessarily mean reaching 100 CPU or memory usage. Each application must have health checks, and in this case, Rust application fails because many requests start to time out. Now, if you increase the client timeout from 100 milliseconds to, say, 100 seconds, it doesn't mean that Rust would process more requests. No, it just means readiness probes would start to time out and Kubernetes will remove the pod from the service pool. This is a great mechanism in Kubernetes that removes slow or unhealthy applications to maintain service availability. I have another video explaining different types of Kubernetes health checks like liveness, readiness, and more. So if you want to autoscale your Rust application, don't rely on CPU usage for the horizontal pod autoscaler, HPA, or at least set the threshold lower, maybe to 40 or 50%. Or use custom metrics like latency or requests per second to scale. Check out this video where I explain how to integrate Prometheus metrics with HPA. Alright, let me open each graph for the entire test duration. First, we have requests per second graph. Next, we have latency. You might wonder why the latency exceeds 100 milliseconds despite the timeout. Well, I'm using histogram to measure requests, and since the entire function can take even 101 milliseconds, the higher bucket, like 200 milliseconds, gets incremented, which explains those values. I explain how histograms work in the previous Rust versus Go benchmark, including when to use a summary versus a histogram to measure request latency. Next, we have CPU usage. In this case, Golang application reaches 100 CPU usage, while Rust application starts to degrade at around 60%. In other words, it processes requests much slower, and we have client timeouts. For example, a typical request takes less than 1 millisecond, but at around 60% CPU usage, those requests can take 1, 2, or even 10 seconds, which overwhelms application and can make it unavailable. However, thanks to Kubernetes readiness checks and client timeouts, some requests can still be served. Next, we have memory usage. You'll notice a memory spike for the Rust application. This happens exactly when the application starts taking longer to process requests, while more and more requests pile up and memory usage goes up. Then we have availability graph. Most of the failed requests in this case returned 408 status codes, meaning they timed out, which caused availability to drop. Finally, we have CPU throttling. You'll notice that these two applications behave differently. The Golang application uses all available resources to process every single request, while the Rust application slows down at around 60% CPU usage. Now, let's go ahead and run the second test. In this test, we read a file from the local file system uploaded to S3 bucket and write metadata about that file to a Postgres database. Keep in mind that this is optimized Rust code, but I still noticed when handling only a few requests per second, Golang application takes half the time to upload the file to the S3 bucket, and its CPU usage is also lower. On the other hand, the database latency remains about the same between two applications. I believe this is because AWS SDK for the Golang is much more optimized than the one for the Rust. AWS even recently deprecated Rust Lambda runtime, so they don't dedicate as much time to maintaining Rust client libraries. You can still use Rust to create Lambda functions, but you'll need to use generic runtime and copy your final binary there. Both applications can handle 30 requests per second without issues, but beyond that, latency starts to increase. The more requests each application receives, the smaller the performance difference between Rust and Golang becomes. In this configuration, both applications can handle a maximum of 50 requests per second. There may be some bottleneck causing this result, so if you'd like to investigate, please feel free to take a look and create a PR. I'll release a new video if you're able to optimize it further. I used Minio to run these tests, and you can easily deploy it locally for testing. Alright, let me open each graph for the entire duration of the test. Requests per second. Client latency. CPU usage. Memory usage. Availability. Database latency. S3 latency. This measures how long it takes to upload the file to the S3 bucket. I measure the function call inside each application, and you can find the details in the source code. Number of connections each application establishes with the Postgres database. I use Prometheus Postgres Exporter to expose database metrics and scrape them with Prometheus itself. If you think I should create a graph and visualize any additional metrics, let me know. That's all for these tests. Let me know what you'd like me to test next. Maybe different programming languages or open source projects. I also have a lot of other benchmarks that you may find in this playlist. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.